Right. So, our first movie review of the day is going to be for the film Leave the World Behind. Leave the World Behind is based on, it's a adaptation of a book. This is directed by Sam Esmail. Sam Esmail, you might know, he did the popular USA show Mr. Robot, which I very much liked a lot. I thought it was a very good ending to that show as well. So here with his kind of feature film, it is about a family. You know, they're just white and blessed. Decides like, you know what, let's go away. Let's get a vacation. Let's rent a home for the weekend, have some good times. Then all of a sudden, all these kind of strange occurrences start to happen. You know, their Wi-Fi drops out. They can't get a signal on their phones. They go into town. Nobody's there. All these kind of really strange occurrences start happening. They hear this weird noise. All of a sudden, it kind of comes up, this weird kind of piercing sound. And they're just trying to piece together and figure out, you know, all of kind of what's going on. And to add a little bit to this tension is you have Mahershala in the family that we're first following here. You see the husband and wife, who's played by Julia Roberts and Ethan Hawke. And then you see kind of another set of characters kind of enter when we kind of get established with them, where they're, you know, in this Airbnb. And you see that Mahershala Ali, he comes in with his daughter, Mahala, who's played by Ruth Scott. Mahala is the actress, and then Ruth Scott is the character here. And people might know her. She was in Bodies, 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 which I liked quite a bit. That came out, I think it was last year that movie came out. It was one of my best ofs there. So she was in that. So they kind of come back to the home and says like, hey, this is, you know, our place. And we were talking via email, but, you know, obviously there's a suspicion there, because she's like, well, she never actually talked to him over the phone or, you know, did any video chat or face to face with him. So she's, Julia Roberts is very suspicious of that. So they kind of, you know, wary, the Julia Roberts and Ethan Hawke are wary of these people in the home while they're there. So that's kind of the basic setup that you have here of this. It's, you know, kind of, you're a little bit of an apocalyptic type of scenario, or is an apocalyptic type of scenario. Very much, you know, technology is starting to, you know, kind of mess up all around. And, you know, anytime the Wi-Fi goes out, you know, motherfuckers freak out. You know, it could be off for 2 minutes, you know what I mean? And they call in tech support. And the first thing they tell you, did you plug it in? Did you plug it in, plug it out? You know what I mean? Did you do that? Turn it on, turn it back off, you know, doing that, you know, people just freaking out. So imagine that happening over the course of, you know, multiple days, you know, and that really bars your connection with the whole outside world. No phones, no computer, no internet, anything like that. I'm going to pass it to you and get your thoughts. What were your thoughts on Leave the World Behind?
So I'm glad we're talking about this movie. I'm glad I'm talking to you about it, because I do want your interpretation, your opinion. This movie is like, what, 2 hours and 11 minutes long, 2 hours and 20 minutes long?
Yeah, about that.
The entire movie, there, you know, with the boat and the plane crashing and the cryptic warning on the television, Mahershala's texts not going through to his wife. All these things are, you know, building up the tension and fear of what's going on. The movie really doesn't ever leave. It's kind of like Jurassic World: Fallen Kingdom, where they turn the new dinosaur into a monster, and it's a monster movie, but it's like a monster trapped in the mansion kind of movie. We never really leave, the issues never leave the house. What's actually going on in the world, we don't ever really learn what's happening. The way I described it on TikTok when I talked about it was, Leave the World Behind is like a monster movie without the monster. Imagine Jaws without the shark. I'm watching the movie and we get to the end, there's no... what's happening? Like, they're talking about it, it's mysterious, it's ominous, it's cryptic, but we never am I wrong to say we never find out what the actual problem was? Because like, maybe I'm missing something with this movie, because like, I could appreciate how stylized it was, I could appreciate the performances, because it's Mahershala Ali. I'll see anything he's in. Mm. I didn't even know Ethan Hawke and Julia Roberts were in it until I saw the trailer. But Yeah, I did not really like this movie, if I'm being honest. I know some people really did. Some people, I think, saw something I didn't, but yeah, I was really confused when it ended. It just ended, and it's sci-fi thrillers can have an ambiguous ending, but it has to make sense, because if it doesn't, if there's no payoff for everything we just went through for 2 hours, what was the point? What's the movie about? Like, I was really confused. Yeah.
Start off with a positive of it. Good at building tension, I think it does. It's good at very building tension, raising these questions. And like you said, it's not unnatural for a sci-fi movie of this nature to have maybe an ambiguous type ending, as far as left to more of the audience interpretations of things. That's kind of sometimes fairly common with some sci-fi stuff of like, what's going to happen next. The issue I run into this movie is probably the same issues that you have with it, as far as, okay, it's raising a lot of questions. Mahershala Ali kind of comes in. It's like, exactly, you're kind of wondering, okay, what do you do for a living? Who do you really know? How do you know these kind of specific details of kind of maybe what's happening, what's going on? Also this stuff with, again, what is exactly happening? What's causing these sounds? Could it be, some cyber attack? Could it be aliens? Could it be, something other force there? I mean, I guess you could say that some of that is just like, well, that's just all background, because the real focus here is the characters, is the drama between these two families, of kind of what's going on. Because like I said, it's a weird situation. There's a little bit of a confrontation, not any physical or anything, but just as, worry of like these people kind of coming in, you don't know them, and he's trying to introduce himself. Like, well, actually, I own this house. We were talking, which you would think, if you were trying to figure that out, why didn't they say like, well, I can tell you my email address of the email that you sent it to. That would probably be an easier thing to say to him. But I don't know why they didn't bring that up. But and with Julia Roberts' character, I guess you could say she's got some, and I've never really seen her in a role like this before. Have you really, with Julia Roberts? Like, kind of like that.
I have not. I don't know. I don't know if you were about to say it, but she does give a little bit of Karen energy in this movie. It's being black men, it's hard not to see certain situations for what they are. Is she under the impression that this black man can't be the owner of this nice house? I get it. He left his ID in his coat pocket back at where we came from, but like, I don't know. She was really defensive, and Ethan Hawke was like really cool about it. I'm like, why can't you be more like him? I get it. Like, you're in the woods, you're like kind of, but this man and his daughter found the home because it's their home, and they're being very honest about the situation. I understand it's hard to trust them, but like, Ethan Hawke was like, they're good people, they're scared, we're scared, let's just offer them, it's their home. Like, yeah. But Julia Roberts, like, how come you don't listen to your wife? How come you listen to everyone but your wife? And like, it's just, and like her bickering with the daughter, like, bro, like, they had like a lot of unspoken tension with just like the way that they look at each other. So I get that. Maybe the main focus was the tension between the characters, not what was actually happening on the real world. But the movie is called Leave the World Behind, and someone commented on my reaction on TikTok, saying that the daughter, the white daughter, who's like obsessed with Friends, she's like a symbol or like an analogy. She's the one who leaves the world behind. Like, she just wants to finish Friends and see how it ends, and like, her wanting to see how Friends ends is like an allegory for how we want to. It doesn't make sense.
So the daughter is played by Farrah McKenzie. She plays Rose in this, and she's the daughter. They have two kids, a boy and a girl, and then she's the young girl. The stuff with, so like you said, she's binging the show Friends, And much like what people do, you know, once you binge a show, it's like, man, I got to finish. I got to watch the next episode and the next episode. So she's doing that on their trip where they are. And then once the internet goes out, she can't watch the show anymore. And it's like, she's got like, she can't resist. She's like, I need to finish Friends. I got to watch Friends. You know what I mean? You know, and I think a lot of this movie, it's a commentary. And I don't know, I haven't read the book. So I don't know if people who've read the book, is the book like this as well? Is strong in these themes?
Yeah.
But it seems like the movie's trying to make a commentary about technology, you know, the dependence on technology, the humanities, you know, where would they be without the technology current? We're so reliant on it. Like, you have Ethan Hawke mentioning how, you know, he tried to drive into town and he's like, without the GPS, he's like, I just got fucking lost. You know what I mean? Without the signs, and he's like, I didn't, like, I just got confused. I didn't know where I was going and I just got lost for a minute. So yeah, I mean, there's that kind of going on. And I think the show with the whole thing with the friends, and it's like, and they do something at the very end of this movie that I thought was so nail on the head. I was like, oh my God. Like, cause if you know the Friends theme song, it like, they try to play that into like the theme of the movie. If you know the actual, you know,
I didn't hear that. I'm glad I didn't. That's crazy.
Yeah. Because you know, I mean, you know, the Friends theme song, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was like so heavy handed the way they kind of did that. Any more thoughts about this movie there?
I know there was like, it was trendy briefly on social media because apparently the Obamas are producers on the film.
Okay.
And apparently they said a lot of this is accurate or true. But again, what is accurate? Like the warning signs, like we should all invest in a bunker, like an underground bunker, or like we shall be prepared for something, but like what's the thing? It's like 2014's Godzilla by Gareth Edwards. Imagine if the entire movie we hear about Godzilla, you know, we hear about the threats in the story, but we don't ever actually see Godzilla. That's just how I would describe this movie. I'm glad I'm not the only one who's a little lost with this movie, because yeah, just the story, the journey didn't have a destination. It just ended with the daughter alone watching Friends. Like I don't remember where did we last leave Mahershala Ali and his daughter before we moved away to the other house, and like the daughter's like in the basement by herself watching Friends. Like, yeah. And like, we never learned what, like you said, we never learned what Mahershala Ali did or does, who he knows, what he knows, why he knows it. It's a lot of missing pieces from this story. So I gave it 3 stars because it was very stylized. It didn't have that Netflix original kind of look. It looked like something that the director had full control over. And I did like the performances from Mahershala Ali, Ethan Hawke, and Julia Roberts. And is it just me, or like in their old age, Ethan Hawke and Kevin Bacon are kind of interchangeable, like looks wise?
they did have kind of similar facial hair.
Very similar looks, like, you know, like white men probably in their like early 60s, late 50s, and like the Salt and Pepper beat. Like, they had very similar looks, and even their voices, I think, kind of, you know, what's it said in Role Models? If you white, you Ben Affleck.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, with this, like I said, it's good at building some tension, yeah. And just the paranoia that you would have in terms of like, yeah, what if you just lost all communication? You know what I mean? What if that just happened, and the fear of that? You know, how helpless would you be? And you kind of see that there. And then the whole kind of tension with the human element here, you know, obviously there's a little bit of a racial dynamic that kind of plays into things here.
Yeah.
Julia Roberts, like you mentioned, kind of Karen engine. She is kind of throwing out a lot of microaggressions, I guess, as they say, yeah, in here, with especially with the daughter. And Mahershala Ali, I mean, I think he is aware of the situation kind of coming into it, and he's trying to be as, you know, polite and gentle as possible, you know, as soft as possible. He's like, you know, doing everything he can to make every accommodation to them. And then you get the daughter's perspective, because it's like, well, if it is their house, I mean, then obviously, you know, it's like, okay, well, it's our house. We, you know, we coming back, so get the fuck out. You know what I mean? You can kind of understand her perspective a little bit there. Yeah. With everything. But like you said, there's not really a real destination to this movie. I guess if you just want to experience it, it's more of an experience, I guess, of just that, of kind of what's going on and the craziness there. You see kind of few glimpses of other people. Like there's that scene where, you know, Ethan Hawke's driving down the road, and I think you see in the trailer where he gets pulled over by a Spanish woman. And then she can't, you know, and she's just furiously speaking Spanish. And I actually thought that scene was kind of funny because he was so scared. He's like, I just don't understand. I'm sorry. Like, I gotta go. And he just drives off. Like that was, I don't know. I laughed hard at that. That's just, I thought that killed me. But
like,
yeah.
The airplane dropping off the red flyers, and like the Teslas losing control and like piling up on each other in the highway. And like, it's very Shyamalan. Like, he'll throw a lot of symbols and like he'll try really hard to be mysterious and cryptic, but like it won't lead to anything. He was just trying to make a cool movie, you know?
It kind of
felt like that.
Yeah, that's actually a good comparison. Yeah, M. Night, it kind of felt like that. A lot of just like, okay, a lot of images and things.
Yeah.
And like, okay, where is this all leading to, you know? And, all
and then that. When it, and then when it ends, you're like, okay, what the hell was that? What the hell was that?
Yeah. Did you want to do a little spoiler discussion about it a little bit? Or
about Leave the World Behind?
Yeah.
What else can we say about it?
Did you want to do a rating? Give your rating before we do a little bit of a spoiler talk.
So you have TuneIn and you have
Peak is above TuneIn, and then This Is Cinema is above that. Then below TuneIn, you have a Tune Out/Skip It. Then you have a Stream It, Burn It, and Waste the Fucking Film.
You can stream it. Stream it and skip it. You don't have to watch this movie. I watched it only because of Mahershala Ali. Same as May December, but I ended up liking May December for I watched that movie for Natalie Portman. But I ended up liking that movie. With Leave the World Behind, I tuned in because of Mahershala Ali, and I was underwhelmed. Let's say so. It's on Netflix. It's 2 hours long. Maybe skip it. Netflix has dropped better projects as of late. So you don't have to watch this movie if you don't want to.
Yeah. I think I'm right there with you. I think I'd give it a skip it. I mean, besides for some of the performances here, which are pretty good. I mean, Ethan Hawke is usually always reliable as far as giving a good performance. He's really good. Mahershala Ali is always really reliable in that.
It's a really cool cast.
Cool cast. I think, like I said, tension. Good at that. But yeah. it, as far as leading to anything or something meaningful, or, you know, it's like, okay, I mean, seems like the overall thing, technology is bad. I hate to reduce it down to maybe that simple, boil it down to that simplest point, but I don't think there's like much else. Like, it's trying to maybe say something bigger, or trying to do something else, but it's just like, I don't think it really serves all that much here. And it's like, you can have a movie where the danger is kind of not apparent or present all that much, of like, you can maybe have like The Mist kind of play with that, but eventually with The Mist, you eventually, you know, figured out kind of what it was eventually with that, like what was going on. And there's even similar characters you have in like a post-apocalyptic thing, like Kevin Bacon's playing like the big survivalist guy who's got already a stockpile of everything. It's like, how did he even know? Like, it seemed like he was already prepared for this. You know, I guess being on, you know, Stormfront message boards, I guess, is beneficial in some front, I guess. So that kind of was going on. But yeah, I just kind of give it a skip it. Like you said, there's better other things on Netflix to watch. I asked Marley, he was on yesterday with me when we were talking a little bit about this movie. Do you think that like this is for Netflix this year's their like Bird Box, I guess? Or he said it was more like their Don't Look Up.
I was gonna say Don't Look Up. Yeah, this is their political movie of the year that they probably thought was gonna be like fire, like, oh, we're about to drop some heat, but like it kind of comes and goes because it was lukewarm, and like it didn't hit. The story didn't hit, the message of the story didn't hit. So I think this is a good comparison to Don't Look Up, like trying way too hard, hitting the nail on the head, at the same time not really hitting the message home, you know?
Yeah. So two skip-its for Leave the World Behind. So spoiler. So in case you want to know, so what happens? Really, it's really not that much. But in case you wanted to stick around, you wanted to know about it. So what happens? Kind of. There's also a lingering thing in here about like the deers that come around their the little Airbnb. About like they all kind of huddle up and are basically scaring the shit out of the family at one point. And then they, you know, there's a point where they get separated. Like the kid, the boy in the family, he gets really sick. His teeth start falling out and throwing up blood. So then Mahershala Ali, Kevin Bacon, and the son, they go to, I'm sorry, Ethan Hawke. I'm saying, damn, you got me confused with two white dudes in there. With Ethan Hawke, so Mahershala Ali, Ethan Hawke, and the son, they go to Kevin Bacon to try to get some medicine because he knows, like, well, I know this guy's going to have something that may help the kid. So the movie, they kind of at the end, they get split up. Then it's with the daughter of Mahershala Ali and then Julia Roberts, where they kind of, they're doing their whole mission of trying to find the daughter, Julia Roberts' daughter, Rose, where she goes missing. She being a dumbass kid, and then she goes missing, tries to go somewhere, and they do that. I don't know what the point of the whole deers was. Like, why would the deers be trying to attack the humans? I didn't really get that so much.
It was never explained.
I didn't really, like, what's that doing? But, yeah, so they try, and then so in their midst of trying to find the daughter, they get confronted by some deers. That's kind of whole their side mission. Then you find out the daughter is somewhere like in another house that's like, I guess, down the road or something, like in another place down the road. And
watching friends
before you see her watching Friends, she's stuffing her face with all types of shit. She's like, you know, eating M&Ms and Sour Patch and cake. And it's like, damn, girl. It's like, I know. You know, I know you ain't that hungry. I mean, calm down. Like, but she's just, you know, stuffing her face. And then you see her, she walks down and then is in a bunker. And then this bunker's all fully prepped. You know, it's all got all the food for months and years. It's got water. It's got all that stuff. And then you see there's a huge DVD collection. And then you see Friends is on there. She grabs Friends. And then, boom, she pops that in. And then she smiles listening to watching Friends. That's how it ends. There you go. And the movie just cuts off.
Yeah.
And that's kind of her whole big thing, is just constantly talking about Friends. How's like, I want to see how it ends. And she has like this dependent relationship with Friends. A show that, hell, somebody, her mom could have probably told her what happens at the end of Friends. Hell, she probably seen the show. Like, okay, boom, this happened. There you go. That's fucking it. The show ended like 20 something years ago.
Seriously.
Like, there you go. This is what happens. Not even that good of a show. That's what kind of happens there. Do you want to see this? I see some funny. I'm on Rotten Tomatoes. I'm just curious to see what other people gave it. The audience score is super low, but the critic score is high. The critic score, critics gave it 76%, but audiences gave it 34%.
Yeah.
So let me see some of these reviews here. So this person gave it a 1-star. They said, wasted 2 hours of my life. All the way around, weird, zero conclusion to any part of the movie. The acting was way over the top. How about some finality to any portion of this movie? Weird animal stuff and zero ending. Why would a mom sit in some odd hut and stop to pontificate while her weird daughter just randomly leaves the family? Bad acting, producing, and directing. this person gave it 0.5-star. They say, whiny characters. I wanted to that stupid little girl get eaten to death by the deer. Secondly, this was a horrendous goddamn movie, and Obama should be ashamed. This movie is so boring and asinine. This movie seems dragged on too long. A series of preposterous events with no plot development, no explanations. I don't need everything tied in a bow at the end, but they just kick all their laughable apocalyptic events and the questions a viewer might have in a disheveled heap to languish into oblivion. No character development. They're extremely annoying and unlikable, with the exception of Ali, who, despite trying to deliver, couldn't save a very bad film. A lot of people kind of going off on this, I guess. Yeah. I wouldn't be that harsh about it, but
like over the top acting, no, not from those three. That producing, that's just. No. Now you're just talking. Like,
maybe it was based on when Trump came into the White House and he had to give him the keys and everything like that. It's like, oh, this was what it was like.
I mean, like that. It's hilarious.
That was Leave the World Behind. Two Skippets.